What's up, everybody, and welcome back to another episode. For those of you who are new here, my name is Johnny. This is our bus Miles of Smiles, and unfortunately, Regan is not here. I'm here last minute making a video, scrambling by myself, as it has been usually. We got left you guys hanging last week, and that's because I was here last Thursday. Same thing, I think. Yeah, same thing. Scrambling to make a video and was trying to get some content together to be able to make a good video for you guys, and I just couldn't make it happen, and that's the reality of it sometimes. You know, I was a little bit busier with my video work. We just weren't able to get to the bus as much, and that's just the reality of it sometimes. It kind of ebbs and flows. My work ebbs and flows, so we kind of do it as we can, and lately we've been, you know, cranking out work consistent weekends, but also some travel has been playing into that as well. You know, my trip skiing, then we were with Regan's family, now we're going to be with Regan's family again for part of the weekend this weekend, and then we'll be gone again. So those weekends are key for us, and eliminating those eliminates some work, but we're trying to make it up any way we can. So here I am, Thursday, it's 10 a.m., and I'm here to scramble and get something together for you guys, but a ton has been happening that we haven't showed you guys, not even on Instagram, really. Maybe a little bit on the stories, but no posts, but we have all sorts of exciting things going on, so I'm crunched for time here also. We got somebody coming to our house to quote some carpet work at 3 o'clock, so I'm crunched for time, and I also have a half-hour drive back home, so I need to be there. We're really scrambling, guys, but we're gonna get this video out to you this week. We need to get on a consistent schedule again. So first, before I get working, I thought something that would be fun and easy to do for this video would be to give you guys a tour of where we're at right now, and give you a feel for what the heck we're thinking for this interior. You know, we've got a few walls up back here, things are going on, and you've seen them if you watched our videos, but I don't know that we've really done a tour, especially since we've changed kind of our layout since the very beginning. I think we did one maybe when the seats were still in the bus, or when we just took the seats out of the bus, but it's changed since then. Then I can go ahead and show you guys some of the wiring and other things that have been going on the bus, and then I've got some wiring touch-ups to do. I'm going to do that for as long as I can until 2:30 rolls around. Well, probably 2:15 just to be safe, and then I have to head home and meet the carpet man and then try and edit this vlog. So let's get going with a quick tour of what we're thinking. All right, so we'll go ahead and start right here in the front. So you guys are basically standing in the doorway of the bus looking at me, and this is gonna be a sofa, couch, sofa, whatever you wanna call it. And we're actually planning to have this pull out in three separate sections, probably equal sections, and the reason for that being is for what's on the other side. So let me show you what's on the other side. So across from the three-part pull-out couch is going to be our nice little dinette here. And this is about 72 inches long or so. So it's a multifunctional dinette. The table will drop down and the three parts from the sofa can pull out and make a queen bed up here. But not only is the table going to be able to drop down, it's also going to be able to hopefully fold out or pull out, and then we can pull out either side of the couch to make essentially a full U of seating. And that was our main reasoning for wanting the three-part couch rather than one whole piece that slid out. We wanted to have a longer table and something that would be able to utilize the seating on the sofa, but also we wanted it to be something that we could really maximize that seating, and so we'll be able to make a full U around it. And this may make sense right now, it may not, but it'll make sense eventually when we make a video about it. These dinette seats are also gonna have storage under them. This one's probably gonna have a shoe cubby under it just because it's right by the front door. And then this one will actually have seatbelt in it as well. So we are gonna incorporate a few seatbelts here, but this will be one of the positions. So now, next to the couch over here on this side, we're gonna have some counter space. And underneath that counter space is gonna be our chest fridge. We mentioned this on our live stream and maybe mentioned that we've already purchased this, but here's our dual zone chest fridge, 105 liter, I believe, or 105 quart, don't quote me on that. Either side can be fridge or freezer, and this will pull out on big drawer slides, big heavy drawer slides, and then we're hoping actually to maybe be able to also fit a nice big drawer, probably gonna be a junk drawer, maybe some silverware above that. And then next to that is gonna be a two burner propane cooktop. And then this is gonna be where our sink is. So we'll have a lot of counter space here, and then we're gonna kind of fade to the sink. We're also planning on having some small cupboards up here. We want to keep them above the windows so that it doesn't impede our view and things like that, and it just keeps everything more open. But we are planning on having that above the kitchen section, not above the couch area. And then of course, below here, we're gonna have various cabinets, things, drawers, and some storage things. Then in this little space here behind the dinette, what we're planning to do is have just a little cabinet and probably a little coffee bar, just a little bit of area for some more storage, maybe a trash bin or something under there, or maybe storing a toaster oven, all our coffee stuff, things like that. So that's what's gonna go here. And then we're actually gonna put a nice little pegboard here, maybe hang some little plants, things like that. You know, stuff Reagan's in charge of, not me. Some of you have probably already seen this in our kitchen. We put two of these shelves in, but we're gonna put one more in. And the reason we have these mason jars here is because these are gonna go on the bottom shelf. We just gotta screw the lids in here. And so we're gonna have some drinking mason jars and then some shelves here. And then here we are in the bathroom. So this wall here in front of me is the wall that's gonna be there next to that little coffee station, whatever it's gonna end up being. And this is gonna be where our shower is. So here's shower station. Shower head's probably gonna come out somewhere over here. We've got our shower head sitting here, but obviously need a lot of things happening before that goes in. And this is gonna be all tiled out, and then we're gonna have our pooper box here. So I'm gonna have our composting toilet right here, and we're gonna build a nice little box for it, incorporate, you know, a nice area for whatever composting additive we use. But I think it's gonna make for a nice space. This is actually way more space than we were anticipating, and we're really happy. And I've had multiple people say, wow, it's kind of surprising how much space that bathroom has. And you know, for me, I'm like 6'1 or so. So it was important for me to be able to stand up, obviously, throughout the bus, but I can happily stand up in here pretty much all the way to the edge. You know, my head just starts to, maybe it's because I got a hat on, but just starts to barely touch there. So I think I'm going to be happy. And, you know, shower heads usually already aren't at my height sometimes. You know, sometimes they're above, but sometimes they're eye level or below. So, you know, I'm not too worried about it. And I think it's going to be very nice. And we're excited for what's to come in the bathroom, but know it's going to be a lot of work. Thankfully, Nick, if you guys know the channel, you know Nick. He's going to help us tile. He said he loves tiling. So, Nick, you're gonna be our helper there. This little dangly wire just reminded me. We also put our max fan in. So, one max fan here, one max fan here back in the bedroom. Both are in. This one, obviously the wires need to be soldered, but, and everything needs to be wired and a lot more electrical needs to happen in the back. But they're in, which is exciting. And anyways, as I was saying, so you keep walking back, you walk past bathroom on this side, kitchen on this side, your sink here. No sink in the bathroom, by the way. Got a sink right here. Why do you need one in the bathroom? And welcome to the bedroom. I was gonna try and set the camera up, but it just wasn't cooperating. I actually just got a new GorillaPod to try and get some different shots for you guys, and just for our sake, have a little something that can be a little kind of tripod all over the place, but little clamp on things, and put you in some different spots so it's not just always a tripod in the corner. But anyways, so here in the bedroom, you can see we've got our bed frame already made out. Here we've got obviously some space between the windows and where the bed frame or mattress is going to end. So this is going to become kind of headboard storage, so to speak. It's probably some clothes storage. We were originally going to put our hamper here, but now we are putting our hamper in our closet. So you guys know our closet. You can see one of the things we've done recently is we finished paneling it off. We haven't put a floor in it yet, but that's down where the hamper's gonna go. So we're gonna have hanging rod up here and then hamper down here. So we're gonna have a nice big hamper, and we'll probably put a lid on it so it doesn't smell our other clothes up, but it's at least gonna be back here out of the way. Speaking of back here out of the way, you'll also notice we got some plumbing done. So here is our water, city water, and gravity fill back here. You see it kind of zigzags and then comes into the water tank here. 100-gallon fresh water under the bed as well. And then we also started our water pump. So our fresh water is starting to be plumbed here, people, which is another thing that we just did because we started getting parts and things and we were just eager to get the plumbing going because we want to make this bed frame and finish it out. So we got some of this done. So you can see our that pump accumulator tank, and then we actually got a hot water heater. So we already have our hot water heater. That's going to go right here. So this space between, you know, this will just be empty space under the headboard. For that, that'll probably be sealed off by itself. We'll be able to actually crack this window if we want, even while the propane water heater's running, if we want to be extra safe, give it some extra ventilation. But we'll make sure it's ventilated, even though it is vent-free, this Excel water heater. We're still going to make sure well-ventilated. Don't want to mess with that. Another reason we don't want to mess with that is because there's going to be a wall divider here and here. And actually, this is going to be where the dogs are going to sleep. So pretty much this space where I'm standing all the way to about here. So this whole big space here, probably including where my feet are even, that's all going to be dog bed. Dogs are spoiled, I know, but I'm very glad we're going to have a spot for them in a designated area, especially for when other people are on the bus. I think we've talked about this, maybe even in our live stream, but, you know, just for them to have a comfortable spot, especially since, you know, we're going to make it, we're going to wall all this off nicely, make it nice and sealed off for them, make it feel like kind of it's their own little bedroom, you know, have fun with it, and make a nice comfy pad for them. It'll take up a lot of space, but because we have the closet now here in the back, we feel really good about clothes storage. And we got a lot of other space. So this here underneath the bed also will be storage on this other side. And that's why we're going to kind of bias the dogs in this direction, is because that side's just going to be a nice open section for storage. Because there's actually a decent amount of space between the top of the water tank and where the bed's going to sit, I'm hoping that we can kind of create a little shelf here and make a nice area just for storage, maybe a little bit more shallower of bins or something like that, or maybe make some clothes dividers, something in here, because it'll be not terribly hard to access considering this will be all open and whatnot. So I think that's it here on the inside. Well, actually, let's take you back to the garage and go show you what's been going on back there, and that's going to lead us in to the next part, which is wiring and all the exciting stuff we've been doing with the lights and getting those rolling. So let's go there. So here we are in the garage, and I'm going to show you what we've been dealing with, or I've been dealing with, and Nick a little bit, he helped me out recently, what we've been dealing with to try and get these lights working. And basically, we've had to kind of remake the harness. I say that in a way. We'd cut out a lot of wires already, and we had kept ones that we knew were essential to the old lights. We didn't know much when we were cutting them out, but man, have I learned a lot. So I want to share that with you guys and share some tips and tricks on potentially how to read wiring diagrams or decipher your own wires, because they actually are labeled, potentially, depends on the manufacturer. I'm not saying every manufacturer does this, but they are potentially labeled, and this could save you a lot of time. So it'll save you time if you're trying to rewire or if you're just trying to cut out wires as well. So here is what I have been creating. You can see it comes off of all the wires up there, but this is obviously going to get tidied up and put in a corner and whatever, and I'll make this look like its own harness. You can see I've got my three lights here. There's a marker light down here. Marker light up there, and then three marker lights across. I still have to get a center brake light for that. Another marker light up there, three lights over there, marker light there, and then I also did all of the marker lights on the side of the bus, which is five amber on that side and five amber on this side. Before I get into the quick wiring explanation showing you this diagram, I want to show you the finished product, because there's also something else on the outside of the bus that we definitely need to show you and you haven't seen yet. So let's go flick on the lights and show you what it looks like. How good does that look? It looks so good. So the bus used to only have one marker light in the middle. So now we've obviously added a few. We've got a red one back here and then our red marker lights at the top. One over here in this corner still needs to be fixed and I still gotta get some of these plugged in as running lights. These are right now. Anyways, I think it looks amazing. And also, if you couldn't tell, Miles is officially a Woody. So we also added these sideboards. This is something we alluded to a long time ago when we were actually painting the bus, I think. And we finally put them on because we needed to put them on because it's part of our next steps in getting walls on. So we'll go back to that quick wiring explanation and then we can talk a little bit more about these guys and how we fixated them. Okay, so let me give you my quick rundown and what I learned trying to decipher all these wiring diagrams and all of this stuff right here. Luckily, our bus, when we bought it, our bus came with this big old binder full of information. So I actually ended up finding this same wiring diagram, which was for a 1999 International chassis, which ours is a 2000, and it was built in 1999, but it was very similar schematics. And so if you have a similar chassis to that, this may help you out, but it may help you out if you're able to just find your wiring diagram or get sent a wiring diagram or get sent a wiring diagram from a company or something like that. So here you can see this is the one for our brake lights, our turn signals, and our backup lights. We also have one for the marker lights. So real quick, let's just talk about what all this different stuff means here. So here you have nav terminal strip. Basically, that's the terminal in the very front of the bus. So our very front fuse panel that does all the accessories and things like that. That is where it all begins. And then all these C103, C106, C165, all those, I believe, I'm not positive on this, but I figured this is what it was, are all these different quick connect harness points. So these are all different of those varying sizes. They're sometimes, you know, two, sometimes they're 16 or whatever wiring clips. They're white. I'll put a picture of one right here. I'm pretty sure certain that's what all these different things are. So we cut a lot of those out. We had two, I think, still in the beginning for most of these, because like I said, we had most of the harness coming all the way to the back. I'm pretty certain that's what those are. And then another thing to note here is all these different colors. So this one says B, R, Y, W, and you can see the colors kind of change here. This is all the coloring of the original harness. Now we cut out most of this harness here back in this area. So I'd say we probably have up to here, and then we cut all this out and it was such a rat's nest that we didn't want to deal with it. So we just cut it out and said, we're going to wire it back our own. If we look at our brake light, it starts at terminal strip 3, which I'll show you here real quick. All right, guys, so here are those terminals I was talking about. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So these all correspond to different things like we were talking about in that book. 6 here is our marker lights. I know that one for sure because we were just messing with it. So it starts at terminal strip 3. It's a blue wire, which continues back and has a few connectors, and then it continues back to the right brake light. And it goes from blue to red just before the brake light, then went to white, and then is a ground. And then it also has the center brake light breaking off of that same wire, and the left brake light splicing off of the same wire. So that's exactly what we did. We just went across, we still had this blue wire. We carried it all the way over to the other brake light, spliced off of both of these, and that's all it takes. So the importance of this terminal strip is each of them is supplied power differently and is connected to different things to tell them to trigger when, for example, you push the brake pedal or you signal the turn signal or you want to back up and the reverse needs to signal it. So all these different terminal strips and all that is connected differently up front. And you can see here, you can see for the turn signals, there's two different terminal strips that they come off of and two different colored wires. Now this one's red, this one's yellow. In this one, you can see this is the left mid turn. So that'll be one of the marker lights that will turn into a turn signal, and this is the left turn signal. So that's sort of a very basic breakdown of how this works. Basically, it's just one wire that you run and you splice a few other things off of, and then you ground it. 12 volt wiring is very simple. You know, it's all grounding to the chassis. So I have a common grounding back here, common ground back here with a lot of the wires. These could probably be combined, I think, because it doesn't matter. It's just a ground, but they're all grounded to what is ultimately the chassis. One thing to note about the brake lights. So we have a red light, a backup light, and an amber light. Now, the backup or the red light and the amber light have actually three cables. So one of them is ground, which is the white. One of them is the brake or turn signal when it's engaged. That's the red. And then the black is actually a running light. So you can see I haven't hooked this one up here yet. But there's another wire that is designated for just running lights. And so that's the one that runs for all the marker lights. So I'm going to splice this all the way up, which I already actually have a wire coming down. And I'm going to splice this in so it runs when the running lights come on for the red and possibly for the amber. So another thing I want to talk about real quick in terms of the wires and deciphering your wires that are already in your bus is a lot of these wires have actual markings on them, which I didn't realize, but they have language on them. So for example, the brown wire that feeds a lot of our marker lights is labeled MKLT, marker light. Now, if you look at, let's say, this yellow guy. So the yellow guy feeds the left turn signal. It's labeled LFTN, left turn. So you know, they're trying to make it, or they're trying to help you out. It's just hard to find this information and know if your wires do say that. Now, there is other language on the wires, other things that refer to the gauge and things like that. But if you look for those sets of small letterings bundled together, like this one, BKLT, brake light. And then the backup, I believe, would be BU. But our backup one, we actually had to rerun a wire all the way from the front terminal. So hopefully that was helpful in helping you decipher a wiring diagram if you have one, or trying to figure out wires in your bus. Look at them, look for little abbreviations on there, and look up those abbreviations. Maybe they mean something, maybe they're the same as ours, maybe they're different, but it's pretty similar language, I would imagine, especially if you have international chassis. This is the way probably most of them are wired, or at least labeled. So know that you can look at that. And real quickly, before I get going to work here and soldering some more of these connections, I'll go show you the boards on the outside real quick, and then we'll get going to work. All right, real quick, let's talk about these beautiful boards that we put on the side of Miles. These are red oak boards, got it from Menards. Those of you from the Midwest, you know Menards. They are 1 inch thick, or 1x6 boards. So really they're about 5.5x3/4, I believe. But they're nice finished boards. We sanded them down, we stained them with a golden oak stain, and then I'll put a picture of it here, what we sealed them with. So we're very happy with the turnout. It just took forever. I mean, between staining and letting that sit and then sealing and all the coats you have to do. We did 3 coats of the sealant after this. They recommend that for exterior applications. So we wanted to be safe and make sure it was nice and sealed, but those 3 coats and just not being here all the time, it took a while. So we have these bolted all the way through. You can see the bolts here, bolted all the way through to the inside of the bus. So these are nice and secure. We sealed them with various butyl tape and things, and we're gonna put a nice bead of sealant just across the top here, but I feel very confident this isn't gonna cause us any leaking issues, and it just looks great. It was just a nice little touch to the outside that we've been wanting to add for so long, and now it allows us to panel off the walls on the inside because we don't need access to put bolts in anymore. So that was the reason those really needed to go on, but they needed to go on a long time ago. I'm gonna go ahead and, like I said, I've just got some more wiring to do. I'm gonna get these all running lights going. I still am struggling with the turn signals. I got resistors for them because when you change to LEDs, they don't pull as much power, so you need resistors so that the blinkers don't hyperblink or blink really fast, and they'll actually only blink really fast for me. So I'm having troubles getting them to not just do one fast blink and that's it. The resistors clearly aren't doing the job. I don't know if I need bigger resistors, different resistors. Hopefully gonna get that figured out today. Get all the rest of the running lights good to go. So that's what we're gonna work on for the rest of this vlog. Hopefully put you guys in some situations and get you a little bit closer to the action. I'm no soldering expert, but I'm gonna get some lunch in me and then let's get working. Just turned 2 o'clock and that means I need to get out of here. I need to get headed home. So that's gonna be it for this episode, guys. I know a little bit different, but I felt like we needed to get you back on track and get you up to speed with where we're at. So hopefully you enjoyed the little tour and the update of where the heck we're at with all these projects. We got projects all over the place and we're just trying to chip away at them one by one and keep the videos rolling for you guys. So you know where we're at and you can keep learning along with us. I hope the electrical piece of this video was helpful to some of you with deciphering what you're doing or wiring things together. Hopefully my explanations of being able to read those diagrams and even read some of your lettering on your wires, hopefully that was helpful. I know it's a lot to take in and I've learned a lot as I've been going here and just trying to figure this out on my own because there isn't a ton of information out there about how to read these things if you have access to them, or how to, that there is lettering on your actual wires to tell you what they are. So it's helpful to know this information, and that's why I'm trying to get it out here to you guys. So if you liked anything in this video, if you found anything in this video helpful, if you found it educational, funny, I don't know if it's that funny of a video, but if you found it funny, go ahead, give us a like, and please go ahead and subscribe. We've had a ton of new faces on here lately, and we love watching that number go up because it means more people are hopping along on the journey with us, and that means more people we can share with and hopefully put a smile on your face as we're going along the way and learning a lot. So go ahead, click the subscribe button if you haven't already, and if you have already, thank you so much for being here, and we can't wait to see you on the next one.